Oh, hey, Dave.
Hi, guys.
Why the swimsuit, Dave?
You invited me over for a dip.
I meant hell of a good dip.
Ooh, dip!
Is that hell of a good French onion? Mmm. Who could resist? And bacon horseradish? My favorite.
Go ahead, help yourself.
Grab some chips and dive right in.
Don't mind if I do. Cannonball!
You had to say dive.
Well, at least you didn't dip in head first.
Not just good, hell of a good.
Welcome to Audiogyan with Kedar Nimkar, a podcast that documents insightful conversations with Indian designers, artists, musicians, writers, thinkers, and creatives of all types. Catch us on iTunes or visit audiogyan.com for more Gyan sessions. Here's your host, Kedar Nimkar.
Today, I have Arzan Khambatta with us on Audiogyan. Arzan is a sculptor and has designed some of the most prominent public sculptures in the current time. An architect from Rachna Sansad's Academy of Architecture, Mumbai. He got his first break when he attended a vacation art class from school under the guidance of noted artist Anand Mohan Naik at the late sculptor Adi Davierwala's workshop. Yeah, he now sculpts from metal sheets, strap, rods, pipes, and various other sections that are twisted, beaten, and textured to give in the desired effect. Arzan lives and works in Mumbai. So, thank you, Arzan, for giving us your time and welcome to Audio Gyan.
Most welcome. Pleasure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm really a layman to sculpture in general. So, I've kept some simple questions and please feel free to go as much as in detail as you want.
Sure.
But yeah, we'll be keeping, the topic is around introduction to sculpture.
Sure.
The first thing which I want to ask you is, how do you conceive a sculpture? I mean, what is the process of gathering the material? What comes first, the form or the material? How does that work?
Okay, I'll tell you. So when I started working with a lot of scrap metal. So what interested me was the inherent nature, the form of the scrap itself, in the form of old hinges and old water tanks and gears from cars and stuff like that. Springs, etc., anything. And when I would see that, I would see images within that which had a potential to be joined together and come together as a design. So my initial days, there were no sketches or there were no preconceived notions. I would actually sit with the scrap and let the scrap sort of talk to me and tell me what it actually wanted to become. So just to give you an idea, I would take a carpenter's vise and take it apart. And then I remember making it into a family portrait with three children, stuff like that. So it actually sort of emerged from there. At that time, I didn't have too many tools, so I couldn't alter the material form like I do right now with gas and heat and all that. So I would very much use the pieces as they are. Now, coming from that, maturing from that, going further and further, then I started using raw metal in terms of your sheets and rods and straps, etc. I started doing sketches because most of my work now is site-specific, is custom-made. And then the sketches have to come first because the client wants to see what I have in mind for his space, whether he likes it or not or what. Correct?
Like
I cannot just go blindly and make something. So there, the sketches come first. When I'm doing for a show, it's entirely my own ideas and designs because I don't have the end client in mind. Who's going to buy my sculptures? So it works both ways.
But what is the process when you are doing a non-commissioned work? It is just piecing together and then the form evolves, or you have something visualized beforehand?
I think it's very difficult to describe the actual stages, but I would say yes. Even when I'm walking down the road, something might strike me and I say, okay, fine, let me go to the studio tomorrow and try this idea out. Now, when I go to the studio tomorrow, I see a couple of pieces that I've already started. So I play around with that a little bit. I try and see if the new idea that I have can go into some of the incomplete ones, or should I do something new entirely? So when I'm working, your mind sort of floats around a lot of things, And when I always say that when you're making sculptures for an exhibition, the pieces that come out are a reflection of the exact mood that you're in, So everything that you see around strikes you. Everything that you see around sort of comes together in your minds, gets stored. And then when you're at your studio, all the ideas sort of pour out into something or the other, So sometimes I can conceptualize three new sculptures in one day.
or sometimes just one sculpture in 12 days, you know. Okay. So it's like that. It's a very erratic way of working. There is no definite sort process. Of a guarantee that if I go in the studio today, I'm going to be very creative, you know, something like that.
It sounds like more like a painting itself, because the colors you use also define the mood of the painter. Similarly,
of course, entirely. Yeah, entirely. Yeah, yes, yeah. True. In my case, it is the forms. It is it is whether it is sharp, it is whether it is lyrical, whether it is soft, whether it is heavy. And, you know, so if sometimes I feel like doing wood carving because it gives me that kind of softness. When I smoothen it, it's very therapeutic. You know, sort of you go there and then you see your smooth form emerging out of a rough log. And sometimes when you feel very energetic and grungy, you work on metal, because that's the sharpness of the metal also excites me to some extent, you know.
Correct.
It's like that.
Yeah, it sounds very interesting. So second one which I wanted to ask you is, what is the role of space while making an artwork? I mean, when it's non-commissioned, as you said, while doing exhibitions, do space contextualize art? I mean, this is for your kind of work also, and in general at a sculpture level also. Like, how do you decide spaces? What is the role of the space where you are exhibiting? They define? Yeah,
of course, definitely, yes. So you absolutely said it right. I think that has become my forte over the years, where an architect, a builder, a client, a hotelier calls me and shows the space and says, okay, see, this is the kind of space that I have. This is what the architect has designated for a sculpture. Okay, it ends there. That is his brief. Now, then I take over. Then I see what the function of the building is, whether it's a hotel, whether it's a corporate lobby, whether it's a residence, is it a housing complex? And then the design sort of flows over there. Then I see what are the kind of finishes around. What are the kind of empty spaces around? Is it enclosed in a space, or does it have like loads of volume, like garden space around it? So all these things help me to decide the scale of the sculpture, the design of the sculpture, the material and the form. And then it sort of fits in. Like, just for example, something that I do for a corporate lobby could be in very angular steel sections. Okay. That same thing would not work for a residence. In a residence, I would go more homely. I would go to wood. I would go copper and sort of, you know, then sort of design that way. So 100% the space that you are shown, 100% sort of decides what sculpture you're going to put there. And now, I think with so much experience and so many years of making sculptures custom made, I actually see a space, and I think even the next 10 minutes while the client is talking to me, the visual of the sculpture sort of comes to my mind, you know. It's that fast now, you know, sometimes.
No, but I would slightly deep dive here, because I'd seen one movie which was, I think the name was Square. And it was about a museum and about a square in somewhere in France. So there there was an incident where the person says that if you just keep your purse in this open space, will it be called as an art? Because it's a gallery and it's like open right now. So so similarly, if there is... So I got your point when you said that when it's a corporate structure or when there's a residential.
Yes, correct.
But what happens when there is like completely open-ended background, or there is just open space? So do you create that space, or do you create an environment to justify your expression, or how does that work?
I think what you're saying is right. Yes, on a major level, the space around it would dictate the sculpture. And yes, when I'm putting my sculpture in that space, the immediate space around I would design also.
Okay.
You're right.
Okay.
So I would design seating around at a distance. I would design a mound on which my sculpture would be sitting. If it's a traffic island, then I would design the railing around the sculpture so that everything that is there alongside the sculpture forms a part of the effect of the main sculpture. It's not that I've put a sculpture and then a landscape architect comes and does whatever he wants around it, and then someone else comes and builds a wall or a railing around it, you know. So I totally understand. So first I look at, just let's say I'm doing a sculpture for a traffic island, which I have done. I first look at the overall surroundings at the absolute mega level. And then you come into the detailing closer to the island, and you do exactly what you want starting from the outside of the island right to the center where your sculpture is. So yes, you do design the space around it also to sort of accentuate your sculpture, to sort of give your sculpture more meaning, you know, like
correct,
that.
Correct. Wow. Mm. Wow. That's quite exciting to know, because it's a big space to design.
It's a big space. Yes. Yeah, yes. Yeah. True.
The next I wanted to know is what is the level of abstraction you try and achieve and then stop at a particular point so that the artwork is still relevant to the viewer? I mean, how do you decide that level, that like this level of abstraction is good enough to make the user understand?
I got what you're saying. Okay. So in my case, in the sculptures that I do, I do very few complete total abstracts. I sort of do semi-abstractions of animals, of humans and all that. So I take a human form and I don't do lifelike stuff. I sort of semi-abstract it into cubist forms, into circular forms and all that, whereby it still looks like a figure, but it is abstract. It could be a horse, which, let's say, an artist is sketching with sort of thick marker strokes, and those strokes I actually create in metal, and then I sort of give it a 3D form, so that level of abstraction is there, but the figure is seen. Now, in order to throw a complete abstract out in the public, you require a lot of maturity from the art viewing audience. Abstracts are difficult to appreciate, to understand. Correct. So what I do is, I generally do abstracts within corporate lobbies where sort of it's a multi-use building, whereby I give it form, like for example, let's say Daybreak or something like Growth, etc. I use waves, I use metal and stuff, which is like it's a complete abstract design. You can't point to it and say, okay, it's a human form or an animal form, or it's a cloud or a ship or whatever, you know. So that level of abstraction is decided, I think, in the kind of, again, looking at the space that I'm designing for. And okay, I go completely abstract, or I go semi-abstract, or very seldom I go figurative, totally, you know, so like that.
Interesting. Yeah, and then how do you value your work? I mean, since you're working with these sheets of metal and straps, and sometimes like the earlier work which you have done,
yes,
which I've seen is more from a scrap material. Correct. So how do you like value what you're doing?
See, I'll tell you what. Number one, the value of an artwork doesn't depend on the material. Number one.
Yeah.
It all depends on the kind of detailing there is in the sculpture, the size of the sculpture, and most important, the level of the artist. So the same artist, well, that is me, in 93 I had a different pricing, in 99 I had a different pricing, and slowly there is a climb. There has to be a slow climb. You have to understand that you have to in the art world, you are automatically, if you are very logical and very sort of, how you say, humble, you would place yourself in a certain level with the existing artists around. Okay. And then you take care to see that you don't suddenly jump up and become more expensive than the artist who's more senior than you, you know.
Correct.
And so of course all everything has to be taken into consideration. I'm not talking of a senior artist doing a 1 foot work and me doing a 30 foot work, you know. You understand what I'm saying?
Correct.
In proportion, apples to apples, I think you have to be very careful in your pricing, that you don't go overboard and that you don't underprice, so that your clients don't feel that your price is, oh my God, it's still the same what it was 5 years back. It can't be like that.
Correct.
So there is a very intelligent method of pricing it as per your chronological age of your work, since you started your sculpture, you know.
That sounds like a different, probably a different Audiogyan altogether for this.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's a difficult thing. Believe me, it's a difficult thing to price it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm in the realm of custom-made commission sculpture since a long time. So even for me, like, someone says, okay, you know, immediately, how much is it? I cannot give an immediate reply, because every piece is different. I go back, I think a little, I place it amongst the other sculptures that I've done, I compare it, and then I give a pricing. You know, it's difficult. It is difficult, you know. There is no thumb rule exactly like that, you know.
Interesting. Arzan, I would like to conclude with one last question, which is which is more like a slightly at an abstract level. I wanted to understand, this is slightly taking a detour from what we had already just now. But what is the role of sculpture in the society at large? I mean, there are paintings which have been...
Yes. So basically, I'll tell you what. Let's say the role of art first on a larger level. Hmm. What does art do? If you look at civilizations, if you look at empires which have been formed, everyone has left behind pieces of art and architecture and writing and literature, of course, which all sort of, how you say, sums up what that civilization was about. Got art, it. I think, adds value to life. Sculptures in the open city scenario add value to your city. They act as oasis between this drab city environments for people to sort of look at. Psychologically, people get a break. I'll tell you a very interesting fact. Being an architect. Now, you see New York, the whole plan of New York, Manhattan, is on a grid. It's like a 90-degree grid, correct? You walk through the street, there are skyscrapers which have straight lines, absolute straight lines. Correct. So everything's 90 degrees to the floor, 90 degrees to the sky, parallel to the horizontal and the roads and all that. So suddenly when you see an Alexander Calder in an open courtyard which has curves and all that, immediately your eyes and your mind take a break, even without you knowing it. So these sculptures are literally oases. They form landmarks. And I'm so happy that in my own way, the dolphins that I've done at Verlin Aka, on Google, it comes up as Dolphin Island. Can you imagine? And all the police also refer to it as Dolphin Island. That whole name of the place of the Podar Hospital Junction has changed to Dolphin Island, you know? Nice. So, and I remember going to Marbella ages back. And it's a small city where all the roads leading up to the beach look the same. Okay.
Okay.
And when you walk on the parallel road to the beach, which is like away, you see in terms of the end of the street, you see each sculpture for every street. So it is like people identify that street not by the name. The tourists would know, okay, fine, this is the sculpture. So this is where my hotel is. I got to take a ride from here, you know. So I feel it is so important to put these pieces out in public. I am all for more public art than art in galleries, because I feel a lot more public has to see it, and not only the people who enter galleries. And I feel it adds value to the city. It adds value to the, the environment, I would say, you know, on the whole.
Interesting. And just this strike me just now, it could be a very naive question, but like there are statues also, right? But the statues, sometimes if we consider they are slightly abstract in a sense, then what differentiates between a sculptor and a statue?
A statue, I tell you what, technically a statue is of a political leader or a human form and all that. The sculpture is a sort of where the artist takes a little liberty to twist and turn the form a little and to give it a little, a little joie de vivre. You know, like for example, David is a sculpture.
Correct.
Okay, because there is a certain playfulness. It's of course, you can call it statues also. Yeah. But a statue is more of a political leader. It's of Dada by Nauroji sitting down near the court, stuff like that. But sculptures are modern day art objects, which are 3D art objects. Let's put it that way, you know.
No, but like if you see the statues which are there in Spain and places like that, they generally are considered as sculptors and not statues, right?
Yes, correct. I'll tell you what that is also.
Detailing, maybe the detailing is different.
Detailing, yes. And also the nomenclature, the naming. We call them statues in abroad. No one calls them statues. They only call them sculptures. Here, we still call them statues and sculptures. But abroad, it's only sculptures. It's always been sculptures, you know.
Oh, okay.
So we say statue of Mahatma Gandhi, statue of Dadabhai Nauroji, statue of Shivaji. But you never say sculpture of Shivaji. You understand? Correct. So it's like that way, you know.
Interesting. I think there's a lot more to talk on this, and I would be coming up with few more questions, and definitely would love to have one more audio again with you again. But for now, this is good a note to end this. Thanks, Arzan, for giving me your time, and it was lovely talking to you. Yeah,
absolute pleasure. Thank you very much, Kira. Thank you.
And that's it from today's Gyan session. Catch us on iTunes, Saavn, Stitcher, or any podcasting app you use. Do rate us on iTunes and follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Stay tuned for more Gyan on audiogyan.com. Till then, bye.
I admit it, TV's kind of my thing. I'll pretty much watch any crime show with an acronym in the title. I live for quirky 90s sitcoms, crazy nature documentaries, and even the occasional indie dramedy. All I need is my comfy pants, a classic movie, an all-new medical drama, or perhaps a little Tuesday night tearjerker. So give me a tense courtroom drama, mafia masterpiece, or even a quirkily detective mismatch with a totally by-the-books partner, and I am in. And because I have wireless from AT&T, I get my favorite 60 channels of live TV for a year on them. So saying, bye-bye, cable bill, is kind of my thing, too.
Get more from your wireless plan. Buy AT&T Wireless and get live TV on us. AT&T, more for your thing. That's our thing. Limited time New York Metro offer. Requires a new line on an eligible plan, which starts at $75 per month in DirecTV Now $35 package. After 1 year, DirecTV Now renews at full price unless canceled. Eligibility and restrictions apply. See att.com/live TV on us for details.